So I'm thinking of doing a summer project on physics, and I'd just like to ask you if you think there's a particular aspect of physics that you think a 12-year-old girl like me would be interested in.
Well, there are so many things that you could look into. I envy you the opportunity to choose it, and you should explore. I'll suggest some things you should explore, and then you should see what you find you're falling in love with. So one thing that's very, and I'll mention things that I think are exciting in themselves, but also have a great future. So one is the astronomy of gravity waves. People are now building detectors which will be capable of seeing gravity waves produced by neutron stars spiraling into each other or black holes spiraling into each other. It takes those kind of violent events to distort space-time enough to set it into vibration. People have been trying for many years to see these tiny vibrations. It'll open up a new branch of astronomy that gives us a window into some of the most extreme and therefore interesting objects in the sky, and that's one. Another is quantum computing. There are ideas now of using some of the intricate ideas of quantum theory. Quantum theory tells us the world is much richer than its surface appearance. And we've only begun to tap into the potential richness of it. And by doing that, we may be able to make a new generation of computers that's qualitatively superior to what we have today for difficult problems. Another is what's happening at the LHC and the perhaps discovery of supersymmetry. Another is dark matter. Oh, but I just thought of the right answer to your question. The right answer to your question is you look on the archive, archive.org, and look for a paper by Frank Wilczek called Physics in 100 Years. And I talk about, in that paper, I talk about what I think will be the future. And that, I think, could... You're the future, so that might be helpful. There's also a blog version of that, which is more accessible, maybe a good introduction. I'll find you the reference if you're okay.
Easy tasks, maybe 5 minutes. You know, you got that. Okay, the question. There was a question right up there. That's right. Yeah.
Thank you very much for the talk. It was fantastic. Just a question: if everything were symmetrical, is symmetrical, and you've got the particles and the forces, and you're saying that's part of the same thing, you would expect, at least I think you would expect, that everything would come to equilibrium pretty soon. As it seems, 40 million years down the line, and we've still got interactions, and it doesn't seem to settle down. Is there a chance that there are more things in, because I know that it's a human thing to want beauty, I think, because it's a very subjective.
Yeah. Well, let me answer that in.
Yeah. It doesn't seem that way.
Let me answer that in two ways. First of all, as to this reaching equilibrium, this is an idea that has been talked about in this hall many times before. In the context of the so-called heat death of the universe, that things will run down. Fortunately, there are barriers to reaching equilibrium that are very powerful, and so it's going to be a long, long time before equilibrium is reached. For instance, one of the important barriers is angular momentum. So if things are revolving around each other, they keep revolving around each other. Another barrier to equilibrium is the fact that as stars evolve, instead of getting colder, they actually get hotter. Gravitational forces are a little different in their thermodynamic behavior, and that drives things out of equilibrium. Now, eventually there'll be, if our current understanding of the world is correct, eventually in maybe 10 to the 100th billion years, equilibrium will be reached and the universe will be a cold, dark place. We have plenty of time to address that issue. And I guess another part of the good news is that quantum computers, if we can download our intelligence onto quantum computers actually work best if it's cold and dark and there's nothing to disturb them. The other aspect of your question, I think, is in this talk, because of limited time and limited possibility to address complications, I talked only about symmetry. Another very important aspect of how we understand the world is symmetry breaking. So, and the basic idea there is that we want our equations to be enormously symmetric, more symmetric than the appearance of the world, actually. So I talked glibly about forces and substances being convertible into each other, but no, they're not, really, in observation. The idea that allows us to have symmetric equations and yet, you know, extremely symmetric equations and yet less symmetric behavior in the world is what's called spontaneous symmetry breaking. And it's basically the idea that the world is filled with different substances, or a better way to put it, sorry, is that although the equations are tremendously symmetric, their stable solutions are less symmetric. So you start out with a very symmetric description that's unrealistic, but it carries self-consistently the seeds of its own destruction, so to speak, because you take those equations and actually solve them, you find that the solutions have less symmetry than the original equations. A simple but very nice example of that is a magnet. If you have a magnet, the forces between the different spins in a magnet don't have any preferred direction, but the different spins in the magnet want to align with each other. And therefore, to do that, they all have to pick a common direction. So the stable solutions have to all agree on some direction. Which direction it is arbitrary, but some direction has to be picked out. And so the magnet has less symmetry than the underlying equations. An even simpler example, that's not from physics, but same idea, is traffic. Everybody should either drive on the left or on the right. It doesn't matter which one you do, but everybody has to agree to do the same thing. Otherwise, it's unstable. So the underlying symmetry of the possible patterns of traffic can't be maintained in reality, and you have spontaneous symmetry breaking. And it could go in different ways, as we see on different sides of the Atlantic.
Okay, great.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. You started out with the question, does the world embody beautiful ideas?
Yes.
You told us about the four yogas of the four forces.
Yes.
It popped into my mind the question, could there be a fifth yoga, the yoga of everything, that would say something like, the world tells ideas what to say, and ideas tell the world how to be?
Yeah, sounds good to me. serious answer to that question is elaborated actually in this 100 years of physics that I alluded to. It's a different subject that deserves its own lecture. But another aspect of the laws of physics that is emerging, I think, more and more, is that Well, first of all, they're very conceptual. That I did show you. But secondly, I can't do justice to that, but the laws of physics are governed by something called action. That's the primary reality out of which everything else emerges. And action turns out to have close analogies to entropy, and entropy has close analogies to information. So I do think that in 100 years, we'll have laws of physics that are formulated in terms of information and its flows. I think that's a very plausible thing that might happen, but we're not there yet. If we got there, it would be wonderful because, you know, as our description of mental processes is becoming more firmly rooted in physics, physics would become more firmly rooted in information, and we'd have another unification. Yeah.
I think there's a question just behind. Yeah. Is that right? Yeah, brilliant. And then do we have a microphone up in the gallery? Anyway, then it would be great if there were a microphone up in the gallery. Brilliant. To go to around there. Fantastic. You first, sir.
Thanks. The question I was going to ask is, we know in mathematics there is a whole spread of beauty of equations about one being proof of the four-color theorem.
Yes.
Infinite number of primes, and there's a whole span between there.
Yes.
Are we in physics, because we've been obviously completely of our experiment, looking for the pretty solutions and then trying to degrade them into what we actually see? Because it's like looking for your car keys underneath the lamp, because rather than where you drop them, because that's where the light's best.
Well, yeah, I kind of alluded to that. Yes, in these unfamiliar realms, we don't have a lot to go on. The experiments tend to be patchy, and so we do use aesthetic considerations and guesswork to propose possible behaviors to nature, but then nature gets to decide whether to use them or not. So yes, we do look under the lamppost, but we've actually found things under the lamppost. So that's encouraging. We'll see if our luck continues. Yeah.
I read an article in the New York Times recently which said...
Don't believe it. All right.
Empirical evidence in modern physics is becoming less relevant. And the example he gave was with supersymmetry,
yeah,
where if the LHC doesn't actually find a supersymmetrical particle, it is possible now, given the complexities of physics, to just say, well, there are heavier particles.
Sure.
And so I guess the question is there a bias towards beauty, and at what stage does one decide to abandon the theory because it's so hard to actually...
Well, a theory that doesn't have consequences in reality is not a good theory. Now, it may be true in some idealized metaphysical sense, but the real magic of physics is that it describes the actual world. So I don't have much patience for theories that don't describe nature in any... And people who propose theories and say, well, they haven't been verified, that that's because nature isn't good enough, or experiments aren't good enough. That to me is lame. Does that answer your question, or are you?
Maybe I could just follow on from some of the things that have been said, which is this, which is sort of the very layman's question about what is the concept of beauty that you're employing here? Because it suggests as though
I should emphasize that not all forms of beauty are represented in physics. The beauty of human faces or human bodies or landscapes that are richly endowed and of moral beauty, those things aren't embodied in physics. Just as we had to learn what aspects of symmetry, which was also kind of a loose term, correspond to things in our fundamental laws, we have to learn what aspects of beauty are embodied in the physical laws. Now, it could be that there were no aspects of beauty that were embodied in the physical law, but I hope I've shown you that that's not the case, that there are profound aspects of beauty that people objectively have found beautiful for a long, long time that are uncannily accurately reflected in our profoundest understanding of nature.
So what that suggests is that you are a realist about beauty, that you think that there is an objective property which we can call beauty out there, which is then, as it were, for us to be discovered rather than invented.
My concept is much more lowbrow and empirical. Okay, we can study art as people have actually created it. That tells you what beauty is. Beauty is not, to me, beauty is not something that's disconnected from human perception. It's very much part of, it's a human thing, right?
Right, and, so it's not a physical thing then?
Well, but we find is that it's, well, humans are physical also. Yeah. So to me, it's a complex relationship, but, and you know, there are reasons that have to do with our nature as physical beings and our origin and evolution, why we find regularities, patterns, things that allow us to get around in the world more efficiently, beautiful.
Yes. You know,
we're rewarded for doing that kind of thing. So it's not entirely a miracle that the world embodies beauty, because we find things beautiful that are embodied in the world.
Yes.
But what to me is really remarkable and hard would have been hard to anticipate is that specific profound aspects of beauty are embodied in very accurate, far-reaching forms in parts of things that we weren't evolved to perceive, but the way the world works fundamentally.
Yes. Fascinating, amazing vision for sort of Kantian to think that there's this circularity between perception and the world. Yeah. Okay, question, yes.
Is symmetry coordinate free? Because it seems to start off with the Galilean relativity, which have Euclidean dimensions, and then there's non-Euclidean geometry, space-time.
Yes.
Can it operate in both systems, or is it
limited
on that perception of what coordinate geometry you're operating?
Well, the real answer to that question would be a little bit technical. But
give it to us.
the basic distinction is the distinction between what are called global transformations and local transformations. So global Galilean symmetry is you move the whole world at a constant velocity and the laws of physics stay the same. And that's a good approximation and describes a wide range of experience. But the deeper reality is what are called local transformations, that you allow yourself to move at different velocities, not only in the whole world, but at different places in space and time. To allow that to be a symmetry, you have to introduce more stuff. You have to introduce these distorting media that can make the equations behave properly, although things look extremely different when you make those transformations. And that leads to the general theory of relativity. So the global transformations lead to special relativity, the local transformations lead to general relativity. In our other theories, really it's the local transformations that have all the power. Those global versions, well, no, that's not true. The global version of electromagnetic symmetry has to do with the conservation of charge. It would take quite a bit to explain that. But then to go from the local symmetry giving you the full Maxwell equations is the deeper symmetry.
So in a sense, dependent on geometry. We couldn't understand it at all without...
Geometry is works hand in hand with physics, always has, and I think always will, because the so the original geometry of Euclid and so forth was abstracted from experience and measuring land and surveying. When people did more things, they found they had to change geometry. They had to think about curved spaces. They had to think about more general spaces with more dimensions and discussing mechanics. In special relativity, you have to unite space and time. In general relativity, you have to allow them to bend. In our theories of the other forces, we have to allow these property spaces. So you can, it's still geometry, but it's a very different subject than the geometry that Euclid knew. It's evolved from it and does more justice to the world, and it's a very much richer subject.
Yeah. So we've got another question up in the gallery. Is the microphone still up there?
So just to,
okay,
while
great.
We're waiting.
Okay, so one there and then one there.
When Galileo talked about how the book of the world is written, he said the world is written in circles and triangles, and you can't, to understand the book of nature, you have to understand that kind of mathematics, that kind of geometry. Well, as we've read further in the book, we found that circles and triangles are not enough. You have to introduce much richer conceptual world to do justice to reality. Yep.
I have two questions. First of all, is beauty intrinsic?
Well, ask the second one, and then
is beauty
we'll have...
intrinsic? Okay, ask the second one first. I'll come. I have to think about that.
Okay, so the second one, you said earlier that at some point in the far, far future, there'll be symmetry throughout the universe.
Did I say that? No, I said that there would be equilibrium. And that, if there are physicists in the audience, that has to be qualified a bit, but basically you'd find equilibrium, which is a sort of symmetry, but not symmetry in the sense I've been using it here.
Okay, so does that not contradict the law of thermodynamics that entropy will increase with time?
No, it fulfills the laws of thermodynamics. It's the entropy increasing in time to its absolute maximum. That's when you have the equilibrium. Now, is beauty intrinsic? Gosh, that's a question for you, I think.
That was my question. to you.
I don't know what that
he
means.
He gave a wonderful circular answer to that very question, which was about the relationship between
perception
and the world.
I can improve on the answer I gave before.
Sorry. Great. Now there's a very patient man who's been waiting there in the gallery.
Thank
yes.
You. Thank you. My question, is it possible there could be a branch of mathematics that's not useful for a physicist?
Oh, there are lots of branches of mathematics that aren't useful. Most of mathematics isn't useful for physics. The vast bulk of number theory is totally useless. Algebraic geometry is mostly useless. I mean, there's been a very fruitful interplay between physics and mathematics, but typically what happens is that mathematicians are inspired by physics to have some basic concepts, but then they go wild with it. So, and then sometimes we find that their exuberance can be used for physics purposes too, but not always. So a good example is projective geometry. Okay, so as I mentioned, projective geometry grew out of the needs, in fact, of art, which is a branch of physics. No. But then took on a life of its own. It took, you know, the artists want to know about objects in three-dimensional space and how to represent them. Mathematicians, you know, immediately leapt to describing spaces of n dimensions, any dimension at all, and fooling around with extra structures and not just lines, but different shapes. And so, you know, mathematicians generalize in all kinds of ways that are have their own internal logic, but are not driven by the physical world and only rarely make contact with it.
Okay, so yeah. We've got time for two last questions. First of all, you in the middle, and then you, sir. And if we'll take them one after the other, and then ask Frank to respond.
So you talk about how force and substance might be convertible to each other. So does that have anything at all to do with wave particle duality?
It would be impossible without wave particle duality. So wave particle duality actually allows a common language to describe what I call forces and substances. The forces are also represented by particles, and the whereas they sort of start as continuous media, and the substances start out as particles but become waves, so they are also continuous media. The distinction between force and substance, however, remains. It's would take a little while to explain in detail, but it's in its rigorous version is the distinction between fermions and bosons. And substance is fermions, forces are bosons, and there are additional barriers besides the duality of wave and particle to trying to unify fermions and bosons. So that's the next step that we're trying to do.
Okay, one last.
When you come across a problem that you can't find a solution to, what are your methods for moving forward with that problem?
Keep trying and think about it in different ways. And and also sometimes pay attention to what other people are doing. Also, you know, part of the art of making progress in science is recognizing which problems are ready to be solved or where you can make progress. And it's a judgment call. It's possible to give up too easily, but it's also possible to just bang your head against the wall and the wall never comes down and you just get a headache. So yeah, it comes with experience and no one is perfect at it, but you just try. It's a human process of solving puzzles and problems.
Well, that seems like an appropriately arduous and optimistic note on which to end. I'm left with the thought that beauty might be in the eye of the beholder, but scientific brilliance certainly isn't. Let us thank Frank for a wonderful talk and discussion.